Welcome to Sato Care, your online nursing channel. This is the second part of the video which discusses the 2017 Anatomy and Physiology University Exam question paper. In our previous video, we saw three questions: the blood supply to the heart, types of muscles, and cranial nerve. So that is the question number one. In this video, we are going to see the second question. The second question, which tells this question, is for 12 marks. In this 12 marks, we have three questions, sub questions. Each question carries 4 marks: the stomach, pituitary gland, the breast. Now we see the first question, the stomach. The stomach is a intraperitoneal digestive organ located between the esophagus and duodenum. The stomach is a intraperitoneal digestive organ where it is located between esophagus and duodenum. Then the shape of the stomach, it is a J shape and it has two curvature, lesser and greater curvature. The anterior and posterior surfaces of the stomach are covered with peritoneal layers. So this is the introduction of stomach. Now we see the anatomical position. The stomach primarily lies in the epigastric and umbilical region. Where it is located? It is located in the epigastric and umbilical region. When you divide the stomach in the abdomen into 9 quadrants, in the epigastric and the umbilical region, the stomach is situated. This is the diagram you have to draw first when you explaining the stomach. The parts of the stomach, like we have the anatomical divisions of the stomach: cardia, fundus, body, pylorus. So these are the 4 anatomical structures of the stomach. What is cardia? Cardia surrounds the superior opening of the stomach at the T level. So by the diagram you can see it is cardia. It is called cardia. It is located in the superior portion of the stomach. Superior means higher, upper. And it is located in the T level part of the thoracic level vertebrae, 11 number vertebrae of the stomach. Fundus. Fundus is the area above the level of cardiac orifice. So opening, this is cardiac opening. In this opening, cardiac orifice means opening. So it is lying above the cardiac orifice of the stomach. The body, the larger central portion inferior to the fundus. So body is the largest area of the stomach. And it is a central portion which is inferior to the fundus. Next one is the pylorus. So here you can see the body. It is lying below the fundus. That's why inferior to the fundus. Pylorus. The area connects the stomach from the duodenum. It is divided into pyloric antrum, pyloric canal, and pyloric sphincter. So the pylorus is the area which attaches the stomach to the duodenum. It is divided into 3 parts: pyloric antrum, pyloric canal, and pyloric sphincter. What are the openings of this stomach? The stomach has 2 openings: gastroesophageal sphincter, which opens to the esophagus, gastroesophageal. So gastroesophageal is nothing but the opening between stomach and the esophagus. The pyloric sphincter, which opens the stomach with the duodenum. So basically there are 2 openings. We have the gastroesophageal opening, which opens the esophagus to the stomach. And also we are having the pyloric sphincter. The pyloric sphincter opens the stomach with the duodenum. This gastroesophageal opening is also called as cardiac sphincter. The next one is sphincter. Same thing, another name we are giving. The gastroesophageal opening is covered by the cardiac sphincter and the pyloric sphincter is present between the stomach and the duodenum. It lies in the bottom of the stomach. The pyloric sphincter lies in the bottom. Cardiac sphincter lies at the top of the stomach. Next one is the curvatures of the stomach. So this is not the eye, this is the stomach, curvatures of the stomach. The stomach has a greater curvature, which is larger in area, and the lesser curvature, the opposite to the greater is the lesser curvature. In this side it is present. The greater curvature, which is a point of attachment for the gastrosplenic ligament and the greater omentum. So in this greater curvature, the gastrosplenic ligament and greater omentum is present. And in the lesser curvature of the stomach, the area of attachment for the omentum, it is like the lesser curvature is the area of attachment for the omentum. The next one is notch. The stomach has two notch, the caudal notch and the angular notch. So notch is nothing but the turn, or we can say it is the pending. Okay, let's see the caudal notch. The caudal notch is the superior angle created when the esophagus enters the stomach. So when the esophagus enters the stomach, the angle created between that is known as caudal notch. What is angular notch? Angular notch, which is a bend on the lesser curvature of the stomach. So the turning, or we can say the bend or the curve, which is present in the lesser curvature of the stomach, is called as angular notch. Angular notch is present down, cardiac notch is present at the top. So this is about notch. The next we see the anatomical relation of the heart anteriorly as well as posteriorly. Anteriorly, right liver, diaphragm, anterior abdominal wall. These are the three organs located related to the stomach. In the posterior, we have pancreas, left suprarenal gland, left kidney, spleen, transverse colon. So the relation of stomach to the posterior side is pancreas, left suprarenal gland, left kidney, spleen and transverse colon. Now we are seeing the blood supply to the heart. Arterial blood supply by three main branches like left gastric artery, splenic artery, common hepatic artery. The venous drainage, the veins of the stomach runs parallel to the arteries. Right and left gastric veins drains in the hepatic portal vein. Next one is lymphatic drainage. Lymphatic drainage is of superior gastric lymph node, suprapyloric node, pancreatico splenic node, subpyloric and omental nodal groups. Okay, these are the four lymph nodes. Superior gastric lymph node, suprapyloric node, pancreaticosplenic node, so subpyloric and omental nodal groups. This is the lymph drainage. The blood supply by three branches: left gastric artery, splenic artery, common hepatic artery. The venous drainage is run parallel to the arteries. Right and left gastric veins drains in the hepatic portal vein. So next we see the nerve supply to the heart, to the stomach. Right and left vagus nerve. It is a parasympathetic supply. It is a parasympathetic supply. Sympathetic supply by splanchnic nerves. Sympathetic supply is by splanchnic nerve. Applied anatomy of the stomach. Gastroesophageal reflex disease, dyspepsia, gastric ulcer and peptic ulcer are common problems related to the stomach. Dyspepsia, that is difficulty in digestion. Gastroesophageal reflex disease, that is the backward flow of gastric content. When the gastroesophageal sphincter is loose, automatically the gastric contents, when you sleep at night, it goes backward flow. Also, there is a Zollinger-Ellison syndrome and gastroparesis. Gastroparesis is the the peristalsis movement of the stomach will be affected. So this is the applied anatomy of the stomach. So hope you understood how to present in exam about the stomach. Next we move on to pituitary gland. Pituitary gland is a master gland. It controls three other endocrine glands. Pituitary gland is considered as the relay center where it sends transmission to other glands like thyroid stimulating, thyroid gland, adrenal gland, and where it gives the signal to secrete the hormones. So this is the very simple diagram which I searched through various sources and I got. This diagram you can draw in the exam when pituitary gland is asked in questions. So where the pituitary gland lies? It lies exactly between the mammillary body and optic chiasma, and the pituitary gland is present below the hypothalamus. So pituitary gland having the posterior pituitary neurohypophysis, and the anterior pituitary which is called as adenohypophysis. So this is the diagram for pituitary gland. Now we see detail about the pituitary gland. Pituitary gland is also called as hypophysis cerebri. The other name for pituitary gland is hypophysis cerebri. It is a small oval structure which is 1 centimeter in diameter, and at the time of pregnancy the size doubles. The position of the pituitary gland, it lies in the hypophyseal fossa. Fossa is nothing but a cavity. It is the body of the sphenoid bone. It lies between the optic chiasma anteriorly and mammillary bodies posteriorly, which I already shown you in this diagram. It is lies between the mammillary body and optic chiasma. Mammillary body in the posterior and optic chiasma in the anterior. Next diagram you have to draw is this diagram, which shows the relation of the pituitary gland to the hypothalamus, cerebellum and cerebral hemisphere. These two diagrams are very easy for you to draw in the exam. The pituitary gland is divided into anterior lobe and posterior lobe. Anterior lobe is known as adenohypophysis, which is a true gland which secretes hormone. Posterior lobe is the neurohypophysis, and it connects to the hypothalamus through hypothalamo-hypophyseal tract. What is the function of posterior lobe? It secretes the hormone which is secreted by the anterior lobe is stored, and also it also secretes some of the hormones, okay, which is under the control of hypothalamic nuclei. Between anterior and posterior lobe of pituitary gland there is relatively small avascular zone called pars intermedia. So this is the avascular zone which is present between anterior and posterior lobes of pituitary gland. Anterior pituitary gland consists of three parts, namely pars anterior, pars tuberalis, pars intermedia. What is the pars anterior? It is the largest part responsible for hormone secretion. Pars tuberalis, it is an upward extension of the pars anterior. Pars intermedia, a thin epithelial layer which separates between pars anterior and pars tuberalis. So this is the three part of the anterior pituitary gland. There are two types of cell which is present in the anterior pituitary gland which have different staining property: chromophobe cells and chromophil cells. These are the two types of cell which is present in the anterior pituitary gland, namely chromophobe cell and chromophil cells. The posterior lobe of the pituitary gland consists of nerve tissue, and this nerve tissues are arise from the embryonic forebrain. The posterior lobe mainly consists of nerve tissue, and these tissues are developed from the embryonic forebrain. Now the hormone secreted in the pituitary gland. Anterior pituitary gland secretes the following hormone: growth hormone, thyroid stimulating hormone, adrenocorticotrophic hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone. The follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone are known as gonadotrophins. The posterior pituitary gland secretes the hormones like oxytocin and antidiuretic hormone. Now we are seeing the blood supply to pituitary gland. Anterior pituitary gland receives blood from superior hypophyseal artery and inferior hypophyseal artery. These are the branches of internal carotid artery. Superior hypophyseal artery and inferior hypophyseal artery. It is easy to keep in your mind. Venous drainage. The short veins from the pituitary gland drains into abutting dural venous sinuses. This is very, very important. Dural venous sinuses. The venous drainage by dural venous sinuses. Keep in mind. Now we see the applied anatomy of the pituitary gland. Pituitary gland, when it is affected with some pathology, it leads like pituitary tumors are most commonly seen problem in the clinical area. When there is excessive amount of pressure in the optic chiasma, the tumors may develop. As a result of the chronic pressure in the optic chiasma, hemianopia and quadrantopia will be developed. Hemi means, you know, that visual, anopia is the visual defect, visual field defect. Hemi, half of the visual field is affected. Quadrantopia, 1/4 of the visual field is affected. There is a defect in 1/4 of the visual field. Pituitary tumors grow into the third ventricle, which causes hydrocephalus. Hydrocephalus is the most common problem because of the pituitary tumor, because when it goes to the hypothalamus, this occurs. So this is about pituitary gland. Now we move on to the third question of today's lecture, is about breast. Breast are present bilaterally in pectoral region. They are modified sweat glands. In male and immature female, breasts are rudimentary, means it is not developed. After puberty, the male breast are fully developed. This is a diagram, easy diagram you can draw in your exam, which shows the female breast. Also, it tells the various part of the breast and the relations of the breast. Now move on to the location of breast. Anterior thoracic wall extends horizontally from the lateral border of the sternum to the mid axillary line. Vertically, it spans between second and sixth intercostal cartilages. Also, it lies superficially to the pectoralis major and serratus anterior muscles. So this is the location of the breast. Location of the breast and the anterior thoracic wall extends horizontally from the lateral border of the sternum in the mid axillary line. And vertically, it spans between second and sixth intercostal cartilages. It lies superficially to the pectoralis major and serratus anterior muscles. Now we see the breast has two regions. Circular body, it is the largest and the most prominent part of the breast. Also, it have an axillary tail. It is the smallest part of the breast. At the center of the breast is nipple. It is surrounded by the breast is surrounded by the nipple. The nipple is present at the center of the breast, and nipple is surrounded by a pigmented area of the skin, which is known as areola. There are numerous sebaceous glands within the areola. These enlarge during pregnancy, secreting an oily substances that act as a protective lubricant for the nipple. There are numerous sebaceous gland which is present around the areola, within the areola. They enlarge during pregnancy, and it also secrete oily substances which act as a protective lubricant for the nipple. The next is anatomical structure of breast. Breast is composed of mammary glands and it's surrounded by a tissue called stroma. Now what is mammary gland? They are modified sweat glands. They consist of series of ducts and secretory lobules, 15 to 20 in number. Each lobule consists of many alveoli drained by a single lactiferous duct. These ducts coverage at the nipple like spokes of a wheel, which you have seen in the diagram earlier. Okay, so which is surrounded by the spokes of a wheel. Okay, now come to the next thing. These ducts coverage the nipple like spokes of a wheel. Next thing, the connective tissue called stroma. This stroma is a supporting structure for the surrounding the mammary gland. It is a fibrous and fatty component. The fibrous stroma condenses to form a suspensory ligament, which is also known as Cooper ligament. The stroma is surrounding the, it is a supportive structure made up of fibrous and fatty component surrounding the mammary gland. The fibrous stroma all condense together to form a suspensory ligament, which is called as Cooper ligament. Now, pectoral fascia. The base of the breast lies on the pectoral fascia. It is a flat sheet of connective tissue associated with pectoralis major muscle. The pectoral fascia is nothing but it is a flat sheet of the place where the breast lies, okay, and it is like a sheet. It is a connective tissue of the pectoralis major muscle. Blood supply of the breast, arterial supply by internal thoracic artery, branches of the axillary artery and branches of the intercostal artery. So these three arteries which supplies to all part of the areas of the breast. The next is about the venous drainage. Axillary and internal thoracic vein drains the blood from the breast to the lungs for purification. The lymphatic drainage, there are three groups of lymph node that receives lymph from breast tissues. Axillary nodes, which receive 75% of the lymphs, and parasternal nodes receives 20% of lymph, and 5% of lymph is received through posterior intercostal nodes. So this is the lymph drainage. Now we come to the end. Nerve supply as done by anterior and lateral cutaneous branches, which is the 4th to 6th intercostal nerves. Anterior and lateral cutaneous branches are the nerves which innervates the breast. At last, the applied anatomy. Three main problems related to the breast clinically are polymastia, a pathological condition where an extra breast is present. It may be more than one. It's common we have two breasts, it may be two or three extra may be present. Polytelia, a condition which is associated with extra number of nipples can be present. This polymastia, external, the extra breast can be present in our axilla area also. Breast cancer is the most commonly affecting tumors of the breast, which needs more clinical attention from all females. Particularly, they have to do breast self-examination regularly to avoid these problems. Now, we come to the end of this today's lecture, part 2 of the anatomy and physiology revision. Thank you for watching my channel. If you have any doubt related to the discussed question, you can comment on the box below. And don't forget to subscribe my YouTube channel, Satu Karyu Online Nursing Channel. We will meet very soon with our third part of the Anatomy and Physiology 2017 question paper, which will be discussing the kidney, muscles of the anterior abdominal wall, and we have one more question also. That is related to the knee joints. These three questions we will discuss in our next video. In the meantime, you subscribe my channel, like my videos and share my videos with your friends. Thank you. Bye bye.